A 40-year-old who hasn't gotten any in a friend group with their own dating problems. Sounds like a classic plotline for another hilarious early 2000 comedy film. Hey guys, welcome back to Flicks Recap. My name is Luke Pelletier, and today we're covering one of Steve Carell's classics, The 40-Year-Old Virgin. This movie is a hilarious watch with friends, and actually probably not with your family. Either way, before we start, be sure to drop a like, leave a comment, and of course, subscribe to Flicks Recap if you dig the commentary. And, as a disclaimer, this video includes my own personal commentary and analysis. It's not a substitute for the film itself. Links to purchase the film are in the description below. Okay, let's do it. We open to a middle-aged man named Andy dragging himself out of bed and trudging on to get the day started. We get the early hint that Andy isn't the stereotypical ladies' man, probably because he doesn't own a car and rides a bike to work. Obviously, this is before the millennial revolution of making bike riding to work look cool. At work, he's greeted by his colleague, Cal, who starts sharing how wicked his weekend trip to Tijuana was. He then asks Andy what he did, and he shares the most boring weekend ever. I mean, I'm a homebody, and even I was just kind of floored at how boring this is. Next, we meet the rest of the gang. David, another one of Andy's colleagues, who's berating his manager, Paula, to stop playing the same song every single day at the shop. Jay, the appointed womanizer of the group, who we see arguing with Mooj, who he thinks just stole a customer from him. David, Cal, and Jay gather up talking about how they're a man short for their upcoming card night. David suggests Andy, but Cal says no because he's suspicious that somebody can't be that boring without having any serious problems. Jay says they have no options and invites Andy. Poker night arrives, and there we see Andy is just crushing the guys. Jay says he has to leave early to meet his girl on the side. Before leaving, Jay gives us an idea of just how crazy this girl is. This starts a succession of stories from the guys about their wildest, encounters, but is ended quickly by David sharing a sob story about his ex. Jay tries to get the mood back up and tells Andy to share one of his. But here, Andy is just left stumbling and uttering the cringiest phrases, all but simply admitting I have no clue what I'm talking about. Obviously, he slips up, and the guys start questioning if he actually ever has done it. Jay then realizes that Andy still has his V-card. Andy tries to deny it, but the guys have come to the conclusion, and Jay has even vowed that it's his responsibility to get Andy some action. The next day at work, Andy hopes that the guys don't remember his secret. And everything does seem to be like the way it was before, but that's until one of their other co-workers that wasn't with them last night calls him out, saying he needs to get his cherry popped. Naturally, Andy storms out of the shop. David runs him down and tries to console him. Andy's still in his feeling when David catches up to him. They both head to a coffee shop, and Andy shares why he hasn't done it yet. David tells Andy that he should take a risk and give it another shot, calling back to the time he risked it with a girl only to end up being cheated on after 4 months. Clearly, David is not going to be the favorite of the friend group here. Still, David goes on to tell Andy to just give it a shot and go out with the boys on the coming weekend. That night, Andy dreams about the failed almost experiences he's had before, and my God, take it from me, they are just... I mean, they're more than embarrassing. They're sad. Heartbreaking, even. Fast forward to the weekend, and Andy is looking like a fish out of water at the club. What a surprise. Jay takes it upon himself to tell Andy what the game plan is. Jay gives a very in-depth tutorial on how to use your peripherals to look for your target for the night. Andy puts it into use and forgets how to actually use his eyes, and starts stumbling through the club while scoping out the area. He sees Cal, who tells him that they've been invited to a bachelorette party, and there he hits it off with a girl named Nikki. Nikki gets driven by the moment and ends up doing the tongue dance with Andy. And by the looks of it, Nikki enjoyed Andy's tongue moves, and asks him if he wants to go to her place. Since Andy doesn't drive, Nikki gathers herself up and does it herself. And wow. Nikki is in bad shape between her friends and one of their marriages to her ex. A broken heart and a little hair of the dog can do that to you for sure. The driving is so bad, though, that they get sideswiped just before they reach her place. And so, hard impact from the car plus hard liquor equals hard luck, taking the form of puke all over Andy's face. The next day, Andy tells the boys what happened to him, and obviously they make fun of him, and basically say better luck next time. The boys head back to the shop where we meet Trish, who's looking for advice on which VCR to buy. All the boys make up lame excuses for not accommodating her, and Andy is forced to go deal with her. And what started as a customer sales conversation turns into Trish giving Andy her details, and tells him to come by her store whenever he has the time. Jay finds out that Andy actually got a girl's number, and they go out to celebrate. There they discuss the various strategies that Andy can use on Trish. They basically spend the rest of the night beating their livers into oblivion and giving Andy a frat boy experience. The next day, Andy comes up to Jay at work and asks if he thinks he's good-looking enough. Jay levels with him, calls Andy a diamond in the rough, and says that he just has to take care of himself a bit more. Jay starts off by saying that Andy should get rid of his hairy gorilla chest. But if you ask me, frankly, that shouldn't be limited to Andy. And if you know anything about Steve Carell, I am sure you know this very iconic scene of Steve Carell dealing with his hairy, nasty, disgusting, wretched gorilla chest. The next day, the boys bring Andy to the waxing salon where all the comedy is about to break loose. Andy curses out every living thing on Earth. Because of the agonizing pain, Andy cuts the session short, ending up with a jack-o'-lantern pattern on his chest. Alright, if you've made it this far, you're kicking back and enjoying the video. Now would be a great time to subscribe to Flicks Recap. Subscribing is absolutely free, and it helps me bring you even more dope content. Okay, plug over. Back to the recap. The next day, Cal strikes up a conversation with Andy and starts sharing his knowledge on women. He starts saying that looks don't matter, Exhibit A. He says his secret is that he knows how to talk to women. Andy gets closed-minded at first, but ends up opening up a bit to learn Cal's strategies. To test out his newfound philosophy on picking up women, Andy strikes up a conversation with a girl at the bookstore named Beth. Andy puts Cal's tips into play, and it actually leaves a lasting impression on her, or as Cal would call it, planting a seed. Cal can call it whatever he wants, but I personally would not recommend to somebody that they should just walk up to a woman and try to plant the seed. I feel like that lends itself to a lot of negative consequences down the road. Back home with his newfound confidence, though, Andy is psyching himself up to call Trish. When he does call her, however, he chickens out and uses a different name. David comes by Andy's place to donate a huge box of adult movies, hoping that it'll inspire the testosterone to hit Andy. At first, Cal gets defensive, but then gives in and even starts a viewing session that night. A romantic one at that, with candles and all that good stuff. The next day, the boys go to a speed dating event to test out all the knowledge that's been learned among the group. Obviously, Andy is freaked out, but he goes along with it. Now, think of this event as Tinder, but in person, and Andy is just getting swiped left like it's nobody's business. Jay is a hot commodity, and David gets to see his ex, Amy. In the end, the guys walk out of there with no matches except for Jay. The next day at work, Jay's girlfriend comes storming in looking for Andy because Jay had lied that she found Andy's dating card from the event and not Jay's. Andy surprisingly catches on fast and covers for Jay. Next, we see David being a total mess since he saw Amy. I am not shocked, I am not amused. Paula decides to send David home for the day and tells Andy that he'll be covering David as a sales rep. As a thank you, Jay decides to throw a party for that night for Andy being a bro when he needed help. Andy gets to the party and finds a lady of the night that Jay has hired for him. Obviously, Andy is pissed and lets the guys have it the next day. The guys counter by saying that he didn't have the cojones to do it himself. And Andy finally starts showing some testosterone for once and heads to Trish's shop. There, he sacks up and asks Trisha to go out with him, to which she happily says yes. The next day, Andy calls Trish to hash out the plans for their date, where she says that she's actually free that night. Andy says yes, and when the conversation goes to what time Andy is picking her up, Andy nervously reveals that he rides a bike and doesn't drive. but Trish surprisingly doesn't care and offers to pick him up. Andy tells the boys that, and they ruin the moment for him, telling him his place doesn't scream suave, and it's actually pretty childish, so they offer to help him out. When Trish arrives, Andy downplays the fact that he has zero furniture in his apartment and tells Trish that they should head out. The date goes pretty well, and Trish actually gives Andy a smooch on the cheek, and we cut to Andy's big moment at Trish's bed. Before they get it on, Trish tells Andy that she'll freshen up and points Andy to where the rubber is. Andy discovers all the possibilities except how to actually put it on. As Trish is getting out of the bathroom, her kids walk in on them, and again, Andy is sent home packing. At work, Andy gives Jay and Cal the lowdown of what happened, and when he mentions that Trish has kids, Jay says that he should back out and never see her again. And Cal says the opposite, and lean into and test her by saying that he hasn't lost his V-card. Andy weighs his options and goes with coming clean, although I'm pretty sure he'll still need a rubber to do that. Fast forward to their next date, Trish apologizes and also fesses up, saying how many kids she has. And before Andy gets to say what he has to say, Trish says that this time they should take it slow and wait till the 20th date to get it in. Andy sees this as an opportunity and agrees to her proposal, which also buys him time not to say what he has to say. The next day at work, it seems like Paula has grown fond of Andy's situation and promotes him to floor manager since he has the highest sales. She even offers to take his V-card if he just wants to lose it real quick. Now, at his new position, Andy gets his first problem as the floor manager, calming down Jay, who's in a heated discussion with a customer. And yes, that would be Kevin Hart. Before Andy can get a word in, Kevin walks out, and we see Jay bawling his eyes out after the confrontation. Jay says that his girlfriend Jill just broke up with him for a very weird reason that involved rubber and inebriation. And the stereotypical montage of dates in every rom-com begins. We see Andy and Trish having a grand old time as we all count down till date 20. In one of their conversations, Andy mentions that he dreams of owning his own store one day, but he still doesn't have the capital for it. Trish mentions that his collectible toys would sell for a lot of money, and she offers to help him out if he wants. And just like that, Andy cleans out all of his toys to sell them. The next day, Trish calls on Andy to help her out with a situation with her daughter, Marla, who's pissed at her for not letting her get on the pill. I guess as a reverse psychology tactic, Andy takes Trish to the clinic. At the clinic, the parents and kids get an orientation on all things regarding doing the deed. When asked if there are any V-card holders there, Marla raises her hand and immediately gets berated. To stick up for her, Andy says that he's one too. And just like that, Marla backs out. During the drive home, Andy makes the excuse that he only said that just to help her out. Marla replies by saying that no, he didn't, which implies that she knows Andy's secret, but promises that she won't tell her mom. The next day at work, Jay is showing off the ultrasound reading of his unborn baby with Jill, who just took him back after breaking up with him. To celebrate, Jay tells Andy that he's throwing a party and that he should come. We cut to the next scene where Andy is filling up delivery boxes to send out, where Trish tells Andy that it's actually their 20th date. And we know what that means. Trish throws herself at Andy and knocks down the box of toys, which just destroys it for Andy, who goes on a tangent about how precious they are, and storms out after the argument to head to Jay's party. At the party, Andy is just riled up and starts scoping out the joint in the style of Jay during his premarital epiphany, which is when he sees Beth, the bookstore girl that he was hitting on earlier, and they don't waste any time. They head straight to her apartment. As Andy and the bookworm are about to get it on, Trish realizes that they should talk this one out and leaves him a message that she's headed to his place. Now, when we see Andy in his escapade, it turns out that the bookworm is a little too freaky for Andy, so he subtly backs out to where he sees the boys in the girl's living room. When Andy gets back to his place, he walks in on Trish checking out the collection of adult movies that David had left for him earlier. She then continues on by asking him if he's had troubles with the law with his addiction. Things get to be a little too much for Trish, and she runs out, and obviously Andy tries to chase her down. Realizing that he's trying to chase her down with a bike, Andy takes a shortcut to cut off Trish at the next stoplight. And he does, but forgets that brakes exist, and slams into the hood of Trish's car, thus flying off of his bike. Trish gets out of her car and tries to help Andy, and this is where Andy finally just says that he hasn't popped his cherry. Andy goes on telling her that that's the reason he's been avoiding them getting together, to which Trish just turns around and says that if you love the person you're with, anything can be amazing. And so Andy and Trish are ushered in at their wedding where they are officially getting married, and when they get to their suite, a hotel staff is cleaning up the room. As they should, they both politely curse at him to get out, and Andy pops his cherry without a hitch. Granted, if you haven't seen this movie by now, you probably know all the jokes, but it's still kinda cool to see young versions of Kevin Hart and Jonah Hill. Let me know what your reaction was to the movie when you first saw it. And of course, be sure to like the video and subscribe to the channel so you don't miss the next recap. Until next time.